In Time a Narrative, and especially Oneself as Another, Paul Ricoeur develops a narrative notion of the self in relation to different philosophical traditions and theories. From Aristotle, he draws a notion of emplotment. Narrative theories such as props help him to reflect upon plot and character. Thinkers such as McIntyre inspire him to consider life as a narrative unity. In other words, he uses different sources for his analysis of personal and ethical identity, as he does in most of his works. Analytic philosophy is one of them. In Oneself as Another, it plays a considerable role in the first half of the book, in which Ricoeur addresses the question, who is speaking and who is acting? It is in analytic philosophy that he finds the most promising account of the identity of the one who speaks and acts, he says. And also later in the book, in the chapter on personal identity and narrative identity, in the fifth study, Ricoeur refers to the English language tradition by discussing the paradoxes of personal identity that he finds at first developed by Locke and Hume, and more recently by Parfit in Reasons and Persons. He finds in Parfit's work, as he writes, the most formidable adversary to his thesis of narrative identity. This paper, however, will not pursue the discussion with analytic philosophy that Ricoeur himself opened, but will situate the narrative self within his notion of the narrative self within the debate that started a few years after the translation into English of Soi-même comme un autre. That was in 1992. In 1996, the notion of the narrative self gained interest in the English-speaking philosophical world because of Maria Schechtman's The Constitution of Selves. A few years later, in 2004, the British analytic philosopher Galen Strawson severely criticized the what he calls psychological as well as ethical narrativity thesis that he claims not only Schechtman but also Ricoeur holds. My aim in this paper is to show the relevance of Ricoeur's phenomenological hermeneutical perspective upon narrative identity for the one in the analytic tradition. I will start with Schechtman's notion of the narrative self and will then relate it to Ricoeur's. After that, I will address Strawson's strong critique in Against Narrativity in order to see whether Ricoeur's narrative self stands up to it. Maria Schechtman's The Constitution of Self starts with the observation that the discussion on personal identity in analytic philosophy in the last decades of the 20th century concentrates upon finding the right criterion of personal identity over time instead of issues closer to lived experience and everyday reality. Identity theorists are concerned with specifying the metaphysical problem of the criterion of personal identity over time, but that problem, she says, does not bear any relation to the practical importance of identity. The practical importance of identity implies that it provides a plausible basis for four basic features of personal existence, namely survival, the deep care that one has for the continuation of one's own existence in the future, moral responsibility, that is being accountable for one's own acts, self-interested concern, that is a particular interest one has in one's own future that one does not have in the future of others, and compensation, the person that receives rewards must be the same as the one who has made sacrifices that led to these rewards. She aims at a notion of identity that answers these claims and criticizes the dominant discussion in the English-speaking world for not answering these what she calls pre-philosophical intuitions. Schechtman speaks of the search for a criterion for personal identity over time as the re-identification question, and she differentiates between two fundamental ways of talking about identity, that is the re-identification question, that is the logical relation of identity, which asks what makes person X the same person as Y at time T. And that is the question that is most often put in philosophical discussions on identity in the analytic tradition. And note that Schechtman does not take notice of other traditions than the analytic one. And the second way of talking about identity that she misses in the analytical discussion, but that is often conflated with the first one, is the characterization question. As she claims, this notion of identity is much closer to everyday life. It pertains to questions such as who am I and what kind of person is she? I will explain both sorts of questions. Re-identification theories imply the presumption that person X at time T1 is not necessarily the same as person Y at time T2. The question that follows is what it is that makes that persons can be considered the same. And re-identification theorists in this respect speak of person stages or person time slices. So what they aim at is a criterion that defines the necessary and sufficient conditions for saying that a person's stage or time slice at T1 and T2 are stages of the same person. Basically, two criteria are found, namely the body and the psyche. The field accordingly has split into two groups, believers of the idea that personal identity should be defined in terms of the continuation of a single human body or part thereof, such as the brain, that is the bodily continuity thesis, and believers that identity should be defined in terms of the continuation of a single psychological life, that is the psychological continuity thesis. Whereas the first consider personal identity to have a physical basis, the latter think that persons ought to be identified with their psyche. Schechtman, on various grounds, decides for the psychological continuity thesis. Her main reason for doing so is that it is better capable of addressing the four basic features of personal existence named earlier. Yet, for her also, this psychological continuity thesis in the end falters because it is not sufficient to understand our common conceptions concerning identity, such as the ones around the four main issues. For I must believe that I can correctly anticipate future experiences, or in other words, that I will survive, and not someone like me. It is I who feels experiences that concern me, self-interested concern, and it is I who, upon taking an action, will experience its consequences, moral responsibility. And this I is not accounted for in the psychological continuity thesis, which leads these theorists to rejecting our common intuitions around identity, and Parfit, with his rejection of identity, is the strongest example. Schechtman, however, takes our common conceptions more seriously and as a consequence suggests to leave behind the endeavor to find a re-identification criterion. Identity should instead be considered on another base, namely as characterization question. The characterization question asks, in Schechtman's words, and I quote, which actions, experiences, beliefs, values, desires, character traits, and so on are to be attributed to a given person, end of quote. In other words, it understands identity as the set of characteristics that make a person who she is. This question is not strictly separated from the re-identification question. Both are closely related for Schechtman, but it does seek to define a relation not between person slices, but between a particular person and particular actions, experiences, or characteristics. It is this characterization question that is answered by Schechtman with what she calls the narrative self-constitution view. For Schechtman, narrative identity accordingly answers the question, what makes a person who she is? In her view, human beings are distinguished from persons as are personal histories from the history of human bodies. At the core of the narrative self-constitution view is, I quote again, the assertion that individuals constitute themselves as persons by coming to think of themselves as persisting subjects who have had experience in the past and will continue to have experience in the future, end of quote. Weaving stories of their lives makes them persons. Personal identity as a consequence entails a reflexive attitude towards oneself, or what Schechtman also calls a particular kind of subjectivity and orientation toward one's life. That person's identity is the content of her self-narrative. Hence, for Schechtman, not all human beings are persons, and not all accounts of oneself count as self-narrative, in particular not the ones that do not cohere with the stories that others would tell about herself. One's life story must be shared with others, she says. It must be objective. I would say intersubjective, but she says objective. The notion of story is developed by Schechtman in terms of a conventional linear narrative that has a plot. Yet narratives do not necessarily have a single form. They are various, and there are also culturally different ones. The question what constitutes a life narrative is answered by her in a later essay with the suggestion that it falls somewhere in between a sequential listing of events in one's history and a full-blown story. A life narrative is a story of how events in one's history lead to other events in one's history, in that history. So an essential characteristic of one's life story is that it should be intelligible and that actions should be understandable in the light of one's life story. And intelligibility implies coherence, albeit that Shechtman allows for degrees of coherence. The narrative can range from being perfectly intelligible, which implies that every aspect coheres with every other, to being a sequence of experiences and events without relation to each other. For personhood, coherence is essential. She writes, to be a person, one must realize that one's beliefs, desires, values, and traits are supposed to support one another. Shechtman even speaks normatively of the right kind of self-conception. Those with a different self-conception, she, I quote, cannot lead the lives we live and will be excluded from certain kinds of interactions with us, end of quote. Also, they have a different kind of subjectivity. A person's narrative self-conception thus must be objective, must be intelligible and coherent. Yet it does not necessarily imply that the one who has a self-narrative is fully self-conscious. In a reflection upon Locke's view of identity as consciousness of past actions or thoughts, Shechtman rather conveys that the past gives us a sense of self, a script, that is an idea of who we are and what kind of story we are living. That implies that having a narrative self-conception includes experiencing the events in one's life against the background of one's life story and feeling the effect, she says, that follows upon doing so. One's life story is not necessarily an explicit story. Shechtman even writes that telling an explicit story is usually an appropriate way of expressing one's, an inappropriate way of expressing one's self-conception. But it is an organizing principle of our lives. It is a lens through which we filter experiences rather than an explicit reflection upon ourselves. She also considers the composition of a person as a soup or stew, in which each experience is an ingredient that co-contributes to the flavor of the whole and is altered by simmering with the others. So, one's narrative self-conception is not fully self-conscious. Furthermore, for Shechtman, one's narrative need not be fully articulated. She concedes that people in real life do very little narrate in a self-conscious way about their lives. Also, we can be mistaken about our motives and acts or unable to speak about certain aspects of our life. Therefore, she maintains that the narrative self-constitution view understands one's narrative as implicit yet capable of what she calls local articulation, which implies that one is able to answer questions about oneself. In an essay of 2007, she explains that these answers need not be elaborate explanations, but the individual must recognize a certain kind of explanatory obligation and be able to meet it for the most part. She speaks of a self-narrative as a dynamic set of organizing principles or a continually developing interpretation of the course of one's trajectory through the world, rather than as a set of articulated facts about one's life. Interestingly enough, she also gives room to unconscious or repressed elements of one's narrative that, however, she calls less fully one's own, in the sense that they are less well integrated into one's life because one is not aware of them and cannot express them and consequently scrutinize them. These elements make that one's own actions and experiences can be incomprehensible to a person and not under control. Yet as the missing elements of one's explicit life story, they are revealing of who one is. And Shechtman speaks of the articulation constraint. Not everything of a narrative needs to be articulated. And her last constraint is what she calls the reality constraint. And that is the constraint that one's narrative should cohere with reality. Extreme cases of errors in narratives are in that way excluded from personhood. She says that they diminish the degree of personhood. So, How does Schechtman's analytic perspective upon narrative identity relate to Ricoeur's phenomenological hermeneutical one? I think that one can safely claim that the basic intuitions concerning the discussion of identity in Schechtman's work and Ricoeur's work are similar. Both object to understanding personal identity exclusively in terms of what Schechtman calls the re-identification question and what Ricoeur calls idem identity. Ricoeur, in discussing Locke, Hume, and Parfit, claims that in the analytic discussion upon personal identity, the notion of idem is central and suggests that identity should be thought of in terms of ips as well. Schechtman suggests that the characterization question is a viable alternative for finding a re-identification criterion. Herewith, I do not want to suggest that idem is similar to re-identification and ipsa to characterization, but I'm just talking about the global intention of Ricoeur's and Schechtman's account. Also, when it comes to the notion of narrative identity, they are close. Both Schechtman and Ricoeur understand narrative identity as the configuration of one's life story that coheres to a certain extent and in which recounted events gain meaning because of their place in the plot. I do not have the time to give a full account of the similarity of both notions, and I will only mention a few points. First one is that for both, the self-narrative forms an ordering principle, a sort of basic orientation that plays a constitutive role in taking actions and making decisions in one's life. Schechtman names this the implicit self-narrative, and Ricoeur considers this unity in terms of one's life plan, or the global project of one's existence that serves as horizon for one's projects and plans, and also it's also the basis for the aim of the good life. Ricoeur does not make explicit whether this yet narrative unity of a life needs to be articulated or not, but he does claim that a life that is not reflected upon is a merely biological life. So that is the first point in which both meet each other. The second one is that for both Schechtman and Ricoeur, the narrative has a strong temporal dimension in the sense that it integrates past and future. As Schechtman explains, the narrative self-constitution view is about personal identity as sameness of the experiencing subject. Narrative creates persistence of experiences, and she addresses her narrative self-constitution view as a phenomenological view herself, meaning that it forms an experiential unity. And for Ricoeur, idem and ipse are answers to identity as continuity through time, albeit that there is almost no constancy in his notion of ipse. But so there's also the temporal dimension that is similar in both. And last but not least, for both, narrative identity implies coherence. Both speak of the notion of plot, or in Ricoeur's case, emplotment. Ricoeur considers a story as a synthesis of the heterogeneous and allows radical reversals of fortune, discordances, but in the end they are part, again, of the story, and as such, concordance wins over discordance. For Schechtman, as we saw, the ones with the right kind of self-conception, that is a coherent self-narrative, are distinguished from the ones who do not have this kind of narrative. So I think that the good thing about Schechtman's work is that she answers questions that in Ricoeur's discussion of narrative identity are left unanswered. For instance, the idea that narrative identity does not necessarily imply a complete and fully articulated life story, but that it suffices to claim that one should be able to answer questions about oneself. Narrative identity hence does not necessarily pertain to a complete story, but one can also speak of it in the case of statements made about oneself in a conversation, for instance. Also, Schechtman is much more explicit about who are excluded from her narrative self-constitution view and cannot be named persons, namely those whose self-conception takes a different form than a narrative. Explicitly included in her account are, for instance, the disjointed stories of people with dementia and the conflicted stories of people in identity crisis, as long as these stories are to a certain extent intelligible. Also, she expresses what counts as a narrative. She claims that the narrative self-constitution view allows a broad range of divergence in identity constituting narrative styles. And what I also find interesting, I already explained it, is that Shechtman explicitly excludes unconscious elements into life stories. I do not think that Ricoeur excludes it, but he also does not explicitly write about it. Yet, the perspectives of both thinkers upon narrative and personhood in other respects are fundamentally different. And it is there that I think that a more full-blown phenomenological perspective upon narrative identity, as Ricoeur shows, is advantages above the, what I would call, analytical phenomenological notion of Shechtman. Firstly, Shechtman continues the analytic discussion upon re-identification in the sense that she allows for degrees of personhood, whereas Ricoeur's phenomenological account of identity leaves that discussion behind. Shechtman is, for instance, concerned with questions around the possible falseness of one's account of oneself, with truth claims. She denies narratives that are not accurate to the facts personhood, or writes that they have a decreased level of personhood. Even though she suggests the narrative self-constitution view as an alternative for the re-identification view and objects to understanding persons in terms of stages or time slices, it is especially her reality constraint that makes her allow for differentiations in amount of personhood. And Ricoeur, in contrast, of course, points to the existential signification of selfhood, which implies its corporal anchoring in the world. In his account, personhood cannot differ in quantity. I think it is particularly problematic to relate these degrees of personhood with the idea that one's narrative functions as a sort of basic orientation within life. Shechtman seems to play hopscotch on two legs. That's a Dutch saying. I don't know whether it's also English, but on the one hand, she remains close to the re-identification theorists in thinking in terms of degrees of personhood, which implies that personhood is quantitative. And on the other hand, she embraces a phenomenological view upon personhood in which it is related to self-experience and qualitative, I would say. In her essay of 2007, she corrects this ambiguous view upon narrative self-constitution by distinguishing between self and person. The self is a subject of experiences that forms a psychological entity, and the person is, as she writes, the bearer of complex social capacities that carry important practical implications. So she connects that notion of person with the four features, but the notion of self is a different notion. She claims that, and she makes that claim on the basis of Galen Strawson's critique of the narrativity view that I will address soon. She claims that she came to understand that the tension in her narrative self-constitution view, as person one needs to recognize oneself as continuous, that is, see past actions and experiences as having implications for the present, and recognize a future that is related to present and past. As self, one recognizes oneself as oneself, that is, one identifies with oneself. Yet, in the end, Shechtman again relates both in claiming that, and I quote her, "There are advantages to making one's self-narrative coincide as far as possible with one's person narrative," end of quote. And therefore, in the end, she does not escape from her ambiguousness, I think. A second major flaw of Shechtman's notion of the narrative self is her too simple notion of the body. Shechtman's narrative self-constitution view is an alternative for the psychological continuity thesis, but that thesis presumes a Cartesian body-mind distinction. It starts from the distinction between bodily and psychological continuity, namely, and does not leave that distinction behind. In speaking about the body, Shechtman explicitly relates it with the re-identification question with the consideration of persons as objects in the world. Issues concerning human survival, moral agency, etc., arise only when we consider the person as subject, she claims, which leads us away from the body and to the characterization question and the psyche. Shechtman's account of the body not only implies a reduction of the body, which cannot simply be set aside as a sort of criterion of identity and object, for it is also experience reality subject, But it also leads to a reductivist view of narrative identity. Questions concerning identity that arise in daily life because of physical changes, think for instance of aging, but also of becoming disabled or chronically ill, cannot be accounted for in this way. The only way of dealing with them is to understand them as bodily changes that affect one's psyche, even though she expresses the importance of understanding the what she calls deep connections between human bodies and psychological subjects. Still, her notion of the narrative self upholds a dualistic distinction between body and psyche. I think that Ricoeur's theory in this respect offers more perspective. We've heard more about it at his conference. Already in the early book Freedom and Nature, he situates his thinking within the phenomenological tradition and adheres to Gabriel Marcel's notion of incarnation. The body for him is the existing I, and also in oneself as another, he relates embodiment to the body as object and as subject. Ricoeur more specifically relates embodiment to the Husserlian distinction between Körper and Leib, which implies that it is something that we can objectify while at the same time being thrown into the world as embodied beings. The body forms our situation. Ricoeur also, in Oneself as Another, explicitly rejects identifications such as Schechtmann's of the self with the psyche and the body with the constancy of the self. He objects to identifications of the self with, for him, the body cannot be associated with that which remains the same in distinction to the self as psychological. He also claims not to want to enter into discussions like those in the analytical tradition over the best criterion for identity, psychological or corporal, and as such takes a distance from accounts such as Schechtmann's, who adhere to the psychological continuity thesis. In discussing the analytic notion of the self, Ricoeur speaks of its corporal anchoring in the world. It is precisely this corporal anchoring of the self, of the narrative self, and also the understanding of the self, not in terms of degrees, but as a whole, that separates, in the end, Schechtmann's analytical phenomenological narrative account of the self from Ricoeur's phenomenological one. Apart from being philosophically richer and more consistent, I think that Ricoeur's phenomenological perspective upon narrative identity also offers more clues for applications, for instance, in the field of medicine because of his notion of corporality. Okay, in the last part of this paper, do I still have time? Okay. I want to address a problem that I have with both versions of the narrative self, namely Ricoeur's as well as Schechtmann's, and that I think demands a revision of their claim of coherence of one's life story. And here also Strawson's Against Narrativity comes in. For Ricoeur, concordance wins over discordance, as we have seen, and thus the coherence of one's life story wins over the radical reversal of fortune. And Schechtmann conveys that a narrative is self-constituting when it has a high degree of coherence. Also, in her revised version of the narrative self-constitution view, in which she distinguishes between self and person, Schechtmann claims that both should cohere in the sense that, I quote, lives that encourage affective and emotional identification with the past and future instead of resting with mere cognitive awareness of what one did and projections of what one might do are often made richer and smoother through this effort. End of quote. The problem I have is addressed by the British analytic philosopher Galen Strawson, who in his famous Against Narrativity severely criticized the narrativity thesis that both Schechtmann and Ricoeur hold. He also cites Ricoeur shortly. I can only very briefly summarize his argument. Strawson distinguishes two manners of self-experience, diachronic and episodic. Diachronic self-experience includes experiencing oneself as someone that was there in the past and will be there in the future. In short, the self-experience that is central in narrative self-theses. And episodic people, in contrast, experience themselves as self in the moment and do not consider themselves as continuous with the past or anticipating the future. Because Strawson thinks that an episodic life is as good as a diachronic one, he rejects the narrativity thesis. Schechtmann has defended her view against Strawson. in the 2007 essay that I already mentioned. And I think that at large we can also claim that for Ricoeur, Strawson's objection does not hold. An episodic person for Ricoeur is not really a problem because narrative identity is characterized by the dialectics between idem and ipsa. Episodic self-experience would simply be a narrative identity that is closer to idem than to ipsa. Ricoeur's exemplar for such a self without constancy, without sameness, is the protagonist of Robert Musil's Mann ohne Eigenschaften. Because Ricoeur considers selves as somewhere on the continuum between the relative stability of one's character, which implies idem mainly, and the non-constancy of the promise, that is ipse, he does not exclude the possibility of episodic self-experience. Yet there also is a problem that remains, and that is the normativity that adheres to most normativity theses, including Ricoeur's phenomenological one. Strawson's claim that episodic lives are as good as diachronic ones specifies this problem. We could ask why lives in which persons identify with their past are, as Shechtman writes, richer and smoother than lives in which people do not identify with their past. Why are lives in which people gather together what happened to them more worthwhile as ones that are not gathered, as Ricoeur implies? I will end my paper with an example from a project that I partake in which we interview women that are diagnosed with curable breast cancer. It is on the basis of these interviews that I criticize the normativity of the coherence of one's life story. The interviews show the different ways of dealing with her illness that the women develop. Lisa, for instance, says she tries to live on, close the door and live on. She reports not to have talked about her breast cancer a lot and also did not miss it. Talking about what happened for her does not contribute to dealing with her illness. She simply chooses to leave that episode of her life behind. Other women in the project, such as Donna, write diaries in order not to forget what happened to them. Donna saved all the postcards she received and, together with her diaries, has put them in a box that she wants to keep somewhere as a reminder of what happened to her and perhaps to look through now and then. While Lisa wants to forget, Donna wants to remember. Both are manners of dealing with the unexpected, with discordances that affect one's bodily integrity. I think it should be avoided to understand Lisa's wanting to forget and not wanting to talk and reflect upon her illness in terms of what, for instance, Arthur Frank in The Wounded Storyteller calls not giving sense to her illness, or as a life that is less rich and smooth, as Shechtman would claim, than Donna's, who has given her illness a place in her life and life story. In both cases, the women need to deal with their illness and change body. Both are reminded of the operation by the scar on their breast, for both their body experience is broken. And I also do not think that Donna, because of her articulation of her life story and not wanting to forget, will leave her illness behind more easily. Rather than speaking of coherence of narrative identity and presuming that articulation is better than not expressing oneself, I think we should consider the articulations of one's experiences as characterized by a dialectics between remembering and forgetting. In both cases, it is the aim of the person to make sense of her life. It is just that some prefer to forget the painful episodes of their lives, while others find ways to keep them in the mind. So instead of speaking of coherence, I would rather speak of this dialectics of remembering and forgetting. And I must say that that needs further developing, perhaps also with Ricoeur's latest works, but I haven't done that so far.
I really enjoyed the paper, and I found the example at the end very enlightening for looking at Shechtman's work and realizing some of his limitations. And I think one of the key limitations of his work is that it doesn't take into account what some feminist philosophers would refer to as narratives of oppressed identities or oppressed self-narratives. And Lyndon Nelson, who's written about the importance of developing counter-narratives, would argue that in Shechtman's work, you almost promote this very imperialist view that would assume that there is a certain kind of narrative, that a master plot that's available for the constitution of your own self. And her constraints, especially the reality constraint and the intersubjectivity constraint, are so strong and so limiting as to what kind of identity you can create. So then the question for me becomes, is Schechtman perhaps completely inadvertently then subscribing to this view, not only because she belongs to the conversation in analytic philosophy and still very much follows a similar logic, but because she has a very impoverished notion of narrative, which Ricœur does not have. So the interesting contribution that Ricœur brings is perhaps less so in oneself as another and more in time and narrative, in his notion of mimesis. Because the Ricœur's notion of mimesis, you have the three levels, the prefiguration, the world of action that helps us make sense of the stories that we read, you have to know that an affair is an affair, not a group. Follow a novel, there's the configuration in the plot, but there's also the refiguration. So, you know, stories have the ability to change the world of action, and therefore you can tell a counter narrative, as Nelson would say, that it's possible to modify the world of master plots through the counter narrative that you can tell. But that view is absent in Schechtman. So I think the world of persons that she sees is very severely limited.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much for this suggestion. I think I agree with you that Ricœur's notion of plot is much more elaborated and richer one than Schechtman. So I will look into it. And thank you.
Thank you. It's a really good paper. I'm sorry I came in late. Could you clarify, maybe you already did, the notion of person, picking up on this question? Because from what I heard, is the danger with the notion of person, to kind of reify it, and that really, constrains what you can do. Whereas with narrative identity, you can do quite a lot more. And I just wondered if part of the problem was the notion of person.
I think that Schechtman at large holds on to a distinction that is made in analytic tradition. Yes? She continues the psychological continuity thesis, thinks that what she calls her narrative self-constitution view is a better way of understanding the notion of person, but she stays in the because of her thinking in terms of degrees of personhood, she's still very close to the theorists that she rejects in her book.
But again, you know, person maybe isn't the good thing in this context. I mean, other places.
Yeah. Well. But, yeah.
Because degrees of person just sounds bizarre.
Yeah, it's not. It does sound bizarre. I think so too. So that's why I also made a mentioned her distinction between self and person. That she, in the end, relates to each other. And I think in a phenomenological perspective, self and person wouldn't be distinguished. We speak we wouldn't speak of children, for instance, of having a less personhood. We would think of them as other kinds of persons, perhaps, in a phenomenological perspective.
And I guess that's partly why I thought it sounded reified, you know, that you'd have degrees of persons already. Yeah, anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, yeah.
George, I think there are other resources in Ricœur that might be drawn out, and I agree. It's actually interesting when you talk to, in part in when he's dealing with the concordance and discordance. You talk about concordance winning out over discordance.
Yeah.
Later you talk about dealing with discordance, and if you can maintain the tension, more of a tension between concordance and discordance, and the thing that I would point to that we see elsewhere in Ricœur is the notion of task, the notion of effort, and so that there's an effort to exist, a task. And he talks about this in terms of humanity. Humanity, the task is not given anywhere. And so we think in terms of the narrative that's a task to create an identity that we're trying to establish, and so that we have to stay until you're your examples of a woman who has breast cancer would be a very good, to me, a very good example of something.
Yeah.
Where it's a struggle, it's an effort, and
yeah.
there's not a sense of a common theme, a common, well, the plot is one that it has to do with the both the positive and the negative, and how we struggle to establish an identity over time.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you for that suggestion. Also, the notion of effort is in, enriching, I think. Yeah, yeah. And I've also been thinking, but there are lots of things that should be worked out better. It's interesting in Ricoeur that he makes a distinction. He keeps on making distinction between life and narrative. And I'm not sure whether in Shechtman's account that also is true. So whether it's because for Ricoeur, of course, concordance wins over discordance, but only in the narrative. So there's you can also think of events in life that keep on. Being difficult to deal with for people, and that perhaps can become part of their narrative, but are still experienced as major breaches in life. So Ricoeur leaves the possibility to think that, but I don't know whether Shechtman also does. I doubt it. Yeah.
I think we need to move on at that point.
Okay.